To make it easier to see this presentation, you can maximize your screen by clicking the little box that looks like this in the bottom right-hand corner of the video. So go ahead and click that icon now, and we'll get this webinar started, hosted by Darren Sugiyama and Lionsmark Capital. We hope you enjoy this presentation.
Hi, I'm Darren Sugiyama, CEO and founder of Lionsmark Capital, the most transparent premium financing intermediary in the life insurance industry. So I was on a Zoom call yesterday with an advisor that wanted me to explain what we do here at Lionsmark Capital, things that are unique, meaning one of a kind. And so I took him through a tour of our website because we use our website really as an educational resource for advisors and a destination spot for advisors to learn more about what we do. And he also asked me to record it because he wanted to share it with some other folks in his organization. And it kind of turned into an in-depth podcast kind of format. And so when we finished, I asked him if he would be okay with me sharing this with the advisor community at large. And he graciously agreed. So I hope you enjoy this podcast / webinar / Zoom call recording. So this is our website, lionsmarkcapital.com. It kind of leads off here. It says, I wrote the book on premium financing. I've actually written two different books on premium financing, 12 books in totality. They are being distributed in, I believe, 14 different countries outside the US now. One of the most recent ones is called Premium Finance Life Insurance, The Key to Effective Estate Tax Planning. I actually just put out the second edition of that book earlier this year in 2024.
I actually saw that.
Yeah, the first one I put out, I thought was great, but the problem is this industry moves so quickly that pretty quickly that information was kind of out of date. And so now I'm kind of a masochist, I think. I've signed myself up to release a new edition of that book at the beginning of every year in January because things change so rapidly.
Right, which is incredible if you think about it. You have somebody that is in the field and is very much engaged on what's going on in the industry and how it's changing and then how to adjust at the time of the change to be successful in premium finance, especially.
Yeah, there's a saying I love. It is the better you get, the better you better get. So I'm a constant, perpetual learner and innovator. I also, a little over a month ago, released my 12th book. It's called IUL for Dummies and Aspiring Know-It-Alls. So I'm constantly trying to contribute to the industry, to the advisor community, and also all of my works are client-friendly as well. So there's nothing in any of this content that you'd be ashamed of or embarrassed about showing a client. Our website is really a kind of a destination spot. If you scroll down here, kind of front and center is request a case design. You can click on this right here and it'll take you through the type of policy. So individual or survivorship, and then whether it's going to be a retirement income design or a death benefit design. And then it'll take you to an intake form that has kind of the bare basics of what we would want to see regarding the client's demographic and all that good stuff. Mm-hmm. If we go back, we also page down a little bit more. Here's a video right here that talks about three things that make us really, really unique. Probably the first and foremost value add that we provide advisors and clients is this proprietary backtesting software. So we analyze 121 different actual historical 40-year periods of S&P 500 performance. We built this proxy for the IUL, meaning that we can produce a report that shows simulated cash values based on all these historical returns with the market going up and down, with the floor and the cap, the policy charges mm-hmm. coming out. And so it really gives you an understanding of during really poor sequences of market returns, where in an IUL, you might hit several zeros in a row. It can show you how things might look during those times of volatility. So that's the first thing. Second thing, as we have now, geez, we work with 18 different lenders now. We have 7 different loan models. And so each client's specific situation, whether it be net worth, liquidity, risk tolerance, et cetera, type of assets they have, time horizon, right? How old they are until life expectancy or retirement age or whatever it may be. Each one of those loan models is specifically designed for that specific type of client. And then, of course, there's certain carriers that have certain products that work better or worse. And there are lenders right. that have more advantageous loan terms and less advantageous loan terms based on mm-hmm. that unique client profile.
Right.
And then the third thing is we record a video or produce a video with my voiceover reviewing their actual numbers. That video, I think in final form now, is 14 minutes long. We upload it to the cloud, we circulate the link, and now the advisor has access to that, the estate planning attorney, the CPA, obviously the client's spouse, the client's idiot brother-in-law, you know, whoever it is that wants right. to hear about what the client is potentially thinking about doing, they're hearing it right out of my mouth. It's right. also, so it's a great educational tool, but it's even more importantly, or as importantly, it's a great compliance tool, because if the client ever comes back 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years from now and says, oh, they didn't talk to me about variable returns, they didn't talk to me about collateral calls, they didn't talk to me about all these different things. No, no, no. It's all in that video. So 100% transparency. This video delves deeper into those three things that make us unique.
Yeah.
And this is the clubhouse.
Sorry. Everything's kind of, you know, anything we're going to do of any kind of planned out thought process is always a risk and projections. And that's what you focus on. And it sounds like that's exactly what that video covers.
Yeah. Good, bad, and ugly. You know, there's plenty of good. There's potential bad. And there's really, I mean, the ugly side of life insurance in general, and even more so in premium financing, is lack of disclosure, lack of transparency, lack of client education. You know, this is the book I was talking about a little bit earlier. You can click here and read a couple chapters. You can also order the paperback on Amazon. But this really takes you through some very specific things. Here's a table of contents right here. So mm-hmm. understand the concept, tax-free benefits, how the charges work, how the floors and caps work, how policy drawdowns work, et cetera, et cetera. This video right here are just little clips of interviews with CPAs, attorneys, financial advisors, insurance carriers that I work with, and they talk about what it's like to do business with me. In fact, if you want to see each individual interview, you can click on About Us. Here's my whole team here. Come down here, click on what people say about doing business with us. And here are the interviews in their entirety. I think there's 25 of them on here.
That's a great tool right there.
Yeah. This is a webinar I did for folks that have a net worth north of 20 million and have a minimum IRA value of $1 million. Some of these folks, they don't need the money in their IRA. They're going to pass it on to their kids. And depending on what state you live in, if you're in California like me, after estate taxes and income taxes, that IRA is going to erode in value 70.18%, over 70% due to taxes. Right. If you're in Texas, it's still over 60% total.
That's terrible.
That's crazy. Yeah, it's obscene. Down here, I do several live events. We've got one coming up at the end of the year in Vermont. This is to be determined, but we're working on the final date kind of as we speak. Okay. Advisor services, if we go here, there's a section to request a design. Obviously, we do new cases. If a client has IRA funds they're not going to use, we have an intake form for that. If they want to refinance an in-force premium finance policy where the lending terms are coming back really ugly, we save clients hundreds of thousands of dollars in interest on refinancing the loan. And then the rest of this here, some great educational stuff. There's an FAQ section here that has literally every question that someone might ask in all these different categories here.
Okay. I was kind of looking at that a little bit earlier. That's when I was like, man, this really got a really complete and amazing looking website, and it's very in depth and detailed.
Yeah, it's pretty robust here. So like minimum requirements, we go through carrier minimum requirements, lender minimum requirements, hourly minimum requirements. How old is too old? This is a big one, right?
Yeah.
Talking about suitability. Does this work for retirement planning? You know, does it damage your credit score because you're taking out a loan? I mean, you know, all kinds of stuff like that. And then the webinar library is really robust. I've got more recorded webinars than any rational human being would ever want to watch. Hours upon hours upon hours of content. But for someone that really wants to dig deep, it's pretty deep. It just keeps going and going and going.
Yeah. Which is really great because, I mean, number one, I learned some stuff from that facts area. One of the things I learned that is it doesn't impact your credit score, you know, if you're getting a loan for this type of strategy. And the other thing is what I also learned is like the net worths. And so then I asked the question, okay, like, well, is that liquid or is that overall? And I think I got the answer to this is just overall net worth. So all their assets, you know, combined, it does it equal X amount of $1 million. And if it doesn't, they qualify because they can leverage those assets. Is that correct?
Yeah, well, they can leverage some of those assets. So again, 18 different lenders. We got a lot of breadth of loan terms. So as an example, I've got two lenders that will allow you to use real estate equity as collateral on the premium finance loan, which is very, very unique. I don't know of any of my competitors that have access to that in its pure form. I know sometimes I've heard people say, well, I can use... I have a source to get the client to be able to use real estate as collateral. The deeper you dig, you find out, one, they've never done it before, which is always kind of funny. And two, conceptually, what they're doing is they're going to a secondary lender. Typically, it's a lender that has a relationship with the client already. And they take a piece of real estate and they get that lender to essentially do an asset-backed letter of credit against that property. Now, usually it's a lender that they've done mortgages with before. So they'll usually charge them a point, point and a half. So there's an additional expense. Then that letter of credit can be taken to any traditional premium financing lender. And they'll use the letter of credit as collateral. But that's a multi-step process. It greatly increases the cost. It's not a pure premium financing loan, whereas I have two lending relationships that will literally let you use real estate equity as collateral. And there's a whole formula they use to break down what the net value is they can use. So 18 different lenders. You got, again, a lot of different options. A lot of different options.
All right, keep going.
Yeah. Let's see. What else? Suitability. I know competitors out there where they're a hammer and everyone they see is a nail. Right. They think premium financing is right for everyone. It's not. The general rule of thumb for traditional premium financing is it is not for someone that cannot afford to pay the premiums. That's not what they should finance. They should finance because they do have the liquidity to pay the premiums, but they are choosing to keep those liquid funds working for them in their business or an alternative asset class or real estate or something like that. And then they're leveraging the bank's money to fund the life insurance policy, right? So it's just a matter of conserving liquidity and deploying that liquidity elsewhere into a potentially higher returning asset than life insurance. And it's usually their own business, right? Right. That being said, we do have certain loan models where the client kind of opts for sort of a hybrid type of financing model. What I mean by that is, like in one design, they're paying the first year premium and then out of pocket, and then financing starts in year two. I have another one where they pay a reduced premium in years one and two, non-financed. Financing starts in year three, and starting in year three, say through year 10, client is paying a percentage of the premium, 25 to 33% of the premium, they're borrowing the balance and then they're accruing the interest. So there's a lot, again, seven different loan models like that. The nice thing about having a client pay equity premium into the policy before they start borrowing is it allows the policy value to get a nice running head start to the point where when the leverage is introduced, the policy value is greater than the loan balance. So the policy can serve as the sole collateral as opposed to them having to post outside collateral. Nothing wrong with posting outside collateral, but a lot of folks, regardless of how wealthy they are, they get collateral heartburn. So they get what I call collateral amnesia, and 4 or 5 years into it, they forgot the discussion that said, hey, yeah, you got to start out with whatever, 300,000 of liquid collateral, and by year five, you got to post $1.2 million. Well, they forgot about that. The other tough thing is what happens if their net worth and their assets drastically decrease in value due to a market crash or something, and now they don't have the collateral to post, whereas they did day one. That creates another problem. Another problem is that I've seen is the way that other premium financing firms calculate collateral mathematically is incorrect. They don't understand the actual formula. So in fact, I did a webinar on this where I go deep into it. Page down here. Keep going. Right here, huge collateral calls. So in this webinar, I talk about how collateral from day one is supposed to be calculated versus how all these other firms calculate. And to make a really long story short, you can watch the webinar in its entirety, runs 24 minutes. But the mistake they make is they're showing the policy surrender value on the illustration, let's say in year seven, just as an example. And they're using that policy value relative to the loan balance. And the gap between those two numbers is what they say that the outside collateral need is. Well, that's completely wrong, because that value in the illustration is the end of year value after the index credit has hit. And that's not at that point, that's not the point where the bank calculates the collateral. They calculate it at the end of the previous year, which means that year's index credit hasn't hit either. So they're actually counting 2 years of index credits, neither of which have hit at the point of time where the lender is calculating collateral. And that's why so many clients get that collateral heartburn, because it was under projected from day one. They didn't calculate it properly. It's a crime. It's an absolute crime in this industry, and it's standard.
Right. And that's the sad thing. That's a sad thing. And what we're trying to change as far as the finance industry as a whole. Sad thing, in my opinion, about the finance industry, there's a lot of misinformation, a lot of wrong things knowingly and unknowingly being done, either from lack of information or not caring about correct information and putting your clients first. And in your industry, in your side of the industry, it's the same exact thing. So that's exactly why I'm talking to you and why I want to introduce you to the people that I want to introduce you to, is because they understand that this is an absolute travesty and a crime, and it's underserving and hurting good people in unrecoverable ways, you know, and we want to avoid that. So thank you for saying that.
Yeah, I mean, I'll give you a perfect analogy, almost perfect analogy. Premium financing as an industry is its current state is very analogous to the mortgage lending industry in 2004, right? You had people that had no business buying a second home and buying a third home. They're daisy chaining these mortgage loans together. They're pulling equity from one property, putting it down the other, getting it appraised 20, 30% higher value than what they bought it for, then cashing out on that. And then it's just daisy chain to daisy chain. And we all know what happened in 2008. You also had these overly aggressive negative amortization mortgage loans, where the concept was, oh yeah, you know, buy a house, you can afford $1 million house, but buy a $2 million house, but only make half the mortgage payment. And then just roll the extra interest that's due, just capitalize that back into the mortgage loan. Don't worry about it, because, you know, real estate's doubling every 4 years. And then, of course, crash 2008 hit, and all of a sudden that little magic trick didn't work anymore.
Right.
But that mentality is so pervasive in premium financing right now, and really, quite frankly, has been from the beginning of premium financing, is almost like tricking a client into believing they're going to get a free lunch.
Right.
There's no free lunch. I mean, maybe if you got in 2000 and got out in 2006, there was a free lunch in that little 6 or 7 year period. But right. If you stuck around to 2008, you would have got financially punched in the face. And that's what's happening now with interest rates on the rise. And
right.
A couple of years ago, you had a negative 20-something percent S&P return. And so that negative arbitrage in some of those years can really set off a client and set them in a downward spiral,
100%. Yep. But, and that's a great point.
These are the things no one talks about, and I talk about them very transparently up front. I want to make sure that this is right for this specific type of client. As an example, take a 48-year-old cardiologist making 600 grand a year living in Austin, Texas, versus a small business owner making widgets in the state of California making 600 grand also. I have not seen a cardiologist during a recession out in front of their clinic with a cup in their hand trying to keep their finances alive. But I have seen, tons and tons of small business owners that were doing great 1 year, and next year they're out of business. And right. So that's another thing we want to look at in terms of suitability is this cash flow consistent, and is it going to be consistent in order for the client to be able to service the loan interest payments or whatever it is that they're contributing, to the premium financing model?
Yeah.
Cutting it too thin is not a good idea for anybody,
Yeah. Stability of the career or the business or industry.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, that's the general overview of what makes us different than our competitors. Like I said, our website is a great resource. There's more than enough, content that someone could use to vet us out, vet me out, what I do and how I do it. But I look forward to working with you guys.
Yeah. So let me just kind of give people a little bit of backstory on you. So how long have you been in the financial space in general, and more specifically the premium finance space?
Yeah. So I got in the insurance industry January 3rd, 2003. Had no idea what I was doing. I heard a crazy rumor about an old Little League baseball coach of mine that was making $1 million a year in the life insurance space. My previous career out of college, my master's is in multicultural education. And so I was a teacher in Hawaii. Some people say, well, that's a far leap from what you're doing now. But the reality is I'm still an educator. I'm just educating a different subject matter, So first year in the business, I have my tax return hanging on my wall right up there. My income in 2003 for the entire year was $277.
Yeah, I read that and I saw that in your book.
Yeah. Took a couple of years to get on the right track. And then 5 years in, we were doing just north of 20 million in annual premium, and 37 million by my seventh year. Started writing books about it. In that time, we were in the employee benefit space. Scratch agency, started from nothing, worked out of hotel lobbies until I could afford an office. So we really a grassroots kind of startup. Then I started a secondary agency called Da Vinci Financial. We were selling life insurance to business owners in about 30 different states. Outbound call center, doing all transactions virtually over the phone. This is before COVID, before Zoom, before any of that stuff. So really kind of ahead of the game there. And then from there, that was 2012 when I started Da Vinci. So we had two agencies running simultaneously. There was a third agency I started with my wife called Pacific Bay Insurance Group. My wife's been in the insurance industry 10 years longer than I have. And that agency was in the employee benefit space as well, doing supplemental benefits. almost like kind of an Aflac type of offering. And then, geez, almost 8 years ago, I started Lionsmark Capital, purely doing premium financing. And very quickly, I morphed into 99.9% of my focus was with Lionsmark doing premium financing. And when I first jumped into that space, people thought I was nuts because it's kind of a good old boys club, right? There's the main players, and there's only about a dozen, you know, legitimate main players in the space in the country. And these guys have been doing this for 20, 30 years. And some of them I'm friendly competitors with now. Most of them I'm friendly competitors with now. But what I saw was, and no disrespect to them or to anyone for that matter, but just in general, I felt like clients were not being educated to the level that they ought to be when they're buying a multi-million dollar life insurance policy and they're going in debt $10, $20 million with these banks to fund these policies, right? I mean, this is a significant, I think it's a significant, it's a significant amount of money, right? The stakes are pretty high. And I saw an industry where people were buying things they didn't completely understand from an agent that really didn't understand what they were selling completely.
Right.
From a carrier who, in my humble opinion, hasn't really done a great job in educating agents how these products actually work.
Right.
Now, the argument, and I understand the argument is that, well, we got to keep it simple because these are very complex products. And Darren, people don't want to know the details of a complex product. And my answer to that is there's nothing simple about premium finance life insurance. If you want to take the approach of, trust me, I'm a doctor, I mean, no judgment, but that's not how I do it. And that's not how I think the client should be respected. These folks are very successful, very high net worth. And when doing something this significant, I think they ought to know what they're doing.
Yeah. And they're also extending a tremendous amount of trust in you. Oh. With their entire financial future, because there's negative and positive implications on both sides and very significant ones, you know. Yes.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So the educational side, I felt there was a severe lack of great education from advisor to client in this space. And then from a compliance slash legal slash CYA kind of standpoint, I saw a lack of documentation, verifiable documentation that proved without a shadow of a doubt that certain things were communicated to clients. So with no video recordings, with no extensive disclosures where clients had to sign multiple times in multiple areas regarding all of these different variables, it just seemed kind of like the Wild Wild West.
Right.
And I thought, you know, I want to make sure that the client not only understands what they're doing, but that I have documented that they have acknowledged that they knew what they were doing. Because sometimes, you know, how it is in business with folks, they get amnesia about what was actually
all the time. Better.
Yeah. So I took the stance of, hey, if I lose the sale because I educated the client what this actually was, and there was an element that they didn't like, that they didn't feel comfortable with, and they pumped the brakes and they said, I don't want to do it now, I think that's a positive thing.
Yeah.
I mean, yes, you I want to make a commission. Yes, I make a living selling life insurance, but I want that client to know what they're doing. And if they don't like an element, then they shouldn't do it.
100%. Right?
I mean, come on. This is common sense. This is ethics 101, but there's a severe lack of beacons of truth in this space.
Oh man, I'm so glad to hear you say that, because that's so critical. And I think the only way that a human being should live their life, especially in a space like this, that a very it's a big space with severe consequences if you're not right. So, and that's severe consequences to the client, most importantly, if you're not. and then you will suffer the repercussions. That's just, you know, the golden rule type stuff. Do unto others as you want to do have them do unto you. And so to hear you say how important the ethics is and that you'd rather lose a sale than be unethical, I love hearing that. And I think the exact same way. It protects the client and it protects you. And, you know, people need to make informed, complete decisions on things that are of this magnitude.
Absolutely. You know? I mean, I'll share this with you. I wrote a couple non-industry related books. This one, The Icon Effect, is actually a fictional story, but it talks about the value of having the right mentor and having faith. And things like that. And there's 25 life rules. That's what on the back of this, 25 life rules incorporated into this fictional story that was actually very autobiographically inspired. A couple of years ago, I wrote the sequel to that book called The Takeo Effect. And the story kind of continues on with the protagonist of the story learning all these life lessons. And he learns from this Japanese, very successful Japanese businessman that lives his life based on what they call the Bushido Code. And that's the 7 core principles of samurai. And so to me, this is what defines me as a man, right? This house, cars, money, all that other stuff.
Yes.
That's not who I am. I have this stuff and it's nice and I enjoy all that. That's not who I am.
Right.
I'm a man of honor. I'm a man of, I try to live a life of righteousness. I'm a human being, obviously, flawed human being like everybody. But when we put honor and loyalty and benevolence and again, all these principles that the samurai live by, respect, courage, all these things above money, above ego, above status and all these things that ultimately don't matter. I mean, they're nice and everything, but ultimately relative to the spirit world or whatever you want to call it, what I believe in. Being the right kind of man is far more important than the money in my bank account.
100% agree with that. And man, thank you for sharing those books. I'm getting all your books. I have a couple of your books. I'm getting all of them. So wherever I can find them, is it on your website? Because we're going to go on a book reading spree.
Yeah, no, in fact, if you, I'll share this with you here too. If you go to my personal website, DarrenSugiyama.com, and you click on books and videos, and on here there's links to either Amazon or whatever online vendor distributes these. This is from what I am gathering about you and how you want to live your life, how you want to run your business. This is the place to start right here, the Takeo Effect, by hands down.
Okay, perfect. That'll be my, it sounds like a personal development book, to be honest with you.
That's exactly what it is. It's a fictional story that is greatly influenced by autobiographical experiences.
Yeah. Which is phenomenal. So I'll read your technical books just so I can understand premium financing and all that structure, which obviously plays a huge role in anything that, you know, in my goals and future and plans with premium financing and partnering with you on those things. But then also, you know, like you, I very much value the man more than the material. So, I always say like this when I meet, new people that I might think I want to incorporate into my team or my life in general somehow. It's like I always say, I don't really care what you have. You could have the house, the cars, the money, all this stuff. The only thing that I care about is who you are in your heart as a human being. That is the only thing I care about. And then if you pass that test, then, you know, we can progress from there. And I'll tell you what, sometimes I've been the most disappointed by the people that have the most and seem to be this mythical human being. And I've been more impressed and created a relationship with the homeless dude, literally. You know, like I've made friends with home and I've brought them to my house. We broke bread, like, and done all these things. And I just avoid this mythical human, right, with a bad heart, like the plague, you know. So it was very interesting that you kept circling around in my brain recently. And you're proving exactly why, number one, I want to partner with you and learn premium financing and help execute it alongside you. And then also why I want to introduce the people that I know, because I know we need somebody of your caliber of character of in the space you're in with our mission as a company. So I just want you to know that.
Appreciate you.
That's all that matters is who you are. And you exemplify the right things that we fall in line with and will not negotiate on. That's why all these little changes and things are happening, is because not everything was aligning in the non-negotiable ways, you know? And now we're getting that all together.
Yeah. So. I'm partnering with the right people. You know this, partnering with the right people makes all the difference. I'll share this with you too. I think this might resonate with you. About a year and a half ago, I do these live events, right? Last year, I think I hosted 6 live events, I want to say, in different cities around the country. And at the beginning of last year, I took a risk, and the risk was transparently sharing with attendees. Obviously, we go through the technicalities of premium financing and all that sort of thing. But I shared with them some very personal stories of struggle.
Mm.
I was betrayed by some folks that I partnered with and brought into the business. And it was a really, really awful challenge. And through that process, I learned the power of gratitude.
Mm.
Being thankful for what you have and not focusing on the things that were taken from you, stolen from you, et cetera, et cetera. And part of my healing process and getting through that and rebuilding my company had to do with doing this morning gratitude meditation.
Mm.
And so I share with folks at these live events that I do, I give them that experience. I take them through the gratitude meditation that I went through. Now think about this, right? These folks are coming to learn about premium financing. They're at a premium financing symposium that is sponsored by carriers and banks and all that. And it's a very business oriented event. And here I come along and doing this gratitude meditation where people closing their eyes and we're doing some breath work. And then I take them through understanding the power of gratitude. And I was a little reticent to do it at first. I'm like, are these people going to think I'm some hippie schmippy weirdo? And is this even appropriate? But I felt like God was telling me, look, this is what healed you. There's a lot of people out there that are hurting and they're putting up this front. Like they're so powerful and successful and, you know, impervious to challenge and all that. And we've all been through struggle in different areas
of
personal, business, finances, et cetera, et cetera. And so I started doing this, and it really, I think, shifted my business focus from, instead of trying to appease everyone, I'm just saying transparently, look, this is who I am. This is what I'm about. You don't have to like it. I'm not for everyone. That's fine. But I'm looking for people that want to do the right thing, that care more about the ethics and spiritual side of things more so than just, you know, chasing paper, chasing money.
Right.
So now, in light of, as you know, the death of my 14-year-old son, now I'm having to really double down on my beliefs about doing the right thing and honor, because I'm grieving. And now I have to refocus on, what do I have to be thankful for? God gave me 14, almost 15 amazing years with my son that was such a blessing. And it's tough to focus on that when your heart is so shattered, you know?
Yeah.
But that's part of our journey, right? That's part of our life journey, is we all have crosses to bear and hurdles to overcome. And this is the biggest one I've ever faced.
Yeah. But
the way I feel like I can honor my son's life is to continue to perpetuate the things that I taught him about honor and respect and doing the right thing. So
mm-hmm.
Yeah, it makes all the other things not seem insignificant, but it amplifies the importance of doing the right thing and developing as right. a human, treating people with kindness and respect and that sort of thing.
Yeah. And, you know, Darren, what a number one, thank you for sharing that and being so vulnerable in that. And what a great perspective to have in the face of unfathomable pain you must be feeling. Like, I cannot understand, and I have not felt what that's like, and so I can't understand it. I know that it's tremendous, but what a way to honor your son, and what a way to carry on the lessons that you instilled in him, so he would, you know, grow up to be the man that this world needs, and desperately needs, you know. And you get to carry on, you know, the legacy with his spirit, you know.
Yeah.
And that's amazing.
It's incredible the impact. And I know I'm his father, and every parent thinks their kid's special, right? But it's amazing how he has impacted so many. I mean, we at his memorial service, we got a pretty large venue. We had 360 chairs set up. Over 700 people attended.
Wow.
Yeah, it's crazy.
To make that kind of impact that young.
700 people.
That's insane.
Heard about his life and the type of person that he was. 700 plus people got ministered to about how to live your life in an honorable way. 700 people got to hear people that were very close to him, my friends, and you know, talking about how his life honored God, and it was a powerful experience to be part of that.
Well, I could only imagine.
Yeah. But so I'm thankful. Wow. I mean, again, I'm grieving like you wouldn't imagine, but I'm so thankful for what I did get
for
15 years, you know.
Yeah, you know, I said this the other day, is like, we don't always have to understand, you know, why things are happening the way they're happening. We just need to have faith in the outcome.
Absolutely. Yeah. The minute you start asking why, like, why me, right? That's your ego talking. That's your initial response. But if I'm going to ask why me, that I have to suffer like this, I have to ask, well, why did God send me my wife, who was the perfect match for me? I didn't do anything to deserve it. It was a gift. Why did God grant me almost 15 years with my son? I didn't do anything to deserve it. It was a gift. Why am I able to stand up and walk and talk, and I can breathe, and I have clean water to drink every day. I mean, these are things that, you know, we oftentimes take for granted, but when we really think through it, you know, my worst day is 1,000 times better than some kid on the streets in the slums of Mumbai in India,
mm-hmm.
drinking gutter water. I mean, you know, it's all relative. So we have to be.
Man, that's so true. I've said this a lot too. It's going to tie into exactly what you're saying. You just gave me goosebumps. But I say, look, you know, people complain about America, and we have our problems just like any other part of the world. But I say two things. Number one, at least I'm, you know, not living in a place where I get murdered because I was born the wrong gender and believe the wrong God. And then when people talk about how bad it is here, I say, look, even the most gutter places, the worst places you can find in America are like Beverly Hills to some of the best places you'll find in other parts of the world. You need to open your eyes and go see some real things so you can understand what actual real struggle is. Anything we experience here in America, in my opinion, for the most part, is not severely detrimental struggle. I came from a tough background, but you know what? Like, my life was so damn blessed, even in that moment, because I made it out, I was protected, and I was in America doing it, where they have resources and programs and agencies and stuff that focus on helping kids like me. Other parts of the world, they don't. They get cast out like a dog on the street at 5 years old, and that's their life from that point on.
Yeah.
You know, so I feel you, man, on that 100%. Man, this is an ordained. This is an ordained meeting today. We didn't know we were going to get into all this. You know,
if we had more people here, we could do an altar call. And
yeah, we were coming together for some like understanding and looking at your business. And here we are, just like you were on that stage. We're having a whole ministry of perspectives and understandings and lessons. You know, not just business, but life.
Yeah.
You know, so man, you're a stud.
Yeah, man.
You're just a good dude.
I'm just trying to figure it out, man. Just like everybody else.
Amen, brother. Well, do you have anything else that you want to kind of get back to on the technical side that would just kind of be a good technical preview? Or
that's really it at the moment. I mean,
okay.
Let me go back to. If you go to webinar library, what exactly is premium financing? This is a great kind of premium financing 101 from my perspective. I go through the different loan models. I go through the issues of collateral. It's only 26 minutes long, but it's a great way to kind of see what type of options a client has based on what they're trying to do. I think that's a great place to start.
Awesome. Yeah. And you know, we'll do that, and I'll encourage the people, Andre and Jason, to watch that one specifically so they can just kind of get an inside view. Andre and Jason, they might already know Andre especially, but you know, to review would always be good too. So I'll definitely encourage, they'll see that on this video, so
yeah.
They can click on, hey, Andre and Jason, click on that one.
Yeah, right.
That's the point, you know, of this is like, number one, give, you know, people that I want to partner you with a look at who you are, what you offer, how detailed, how ethical, and how you've created a system to be able to really back test policies and stuff in a way that nobody's ever done in this industry, and what makes you actually stand out. Like, there might be people in your industry that might sell more, right? Like, and get bigger commissions and make more deals, but are they actually doing it, like, to your point, the right way, with complete education, where, you know, the client feels informed and protected and cared for and valued in the right ways? Like, you know, I can really bank my life on this dude, you know? And so having that with you is phenomenal.
So I hope this recording gave you greater insight into what we do here at Lionsmark Capital. But I also hope it gave you a deeper understanding of the principles that we operate by. I think it's really important to know, you know, who you're doing business with, really even on a personal level, and to see if your value systems align with who you're doing business with. Now, you know, I realize I'm not for everyone, right? And that's okay if I'm not your cup of tea. But if you liked what you saw in this recorded Zoom call, you know, I think you'll like doing business with me and my firm. Now, if you haven't heard, my wife, Amelia, and I lost our 14-year-old son last month. He was our only son. And though we deeply mourn this loss that's come with unfathomable pain, you just can't imagine. We're also incredibly grateful that God gave us 14 beautiful years with this incredible boy. I mean, he was kind and generous without being a pushover. He was a great conversationalist, but an even better listener. And he was really an old soul. And based on our own spiritual beliefs, his spirit lives on with us. You know, it's amazing how many lives this little 14-year-old boy touched in a really profound way. Over 700 people attended his memorial service, and the love that we received was really just overwhelming and incredibly beautiful. So I thought I'd end this webinar by sharing with you the tribute video that we played at his Celebration of Life memorial service. It only runs 3 minutes long, but you'll get a glimpse at how beautiful his short 14-year life really was. So I hope you enjoy.
Asleep in my arms tonight, under the stars so bright, King of Kings,
I like him.
So what did we say when we try to do something and it doesn't work out the first time? What do? We never give up. That's right.
Woo! First fish.
The technique that Grandpa Ray taught me.
Special one.